Britain's power and influence has declined since the beginning of the century. And the question is this a trend we can reverse?
We are concerned with making money. That is what we're trying to do.
It's been described as the most beautiful terrace house in London.
The abuse of business and financial power.
You lied.
We shall have a harder Christmas than we have known since the war.
Economic activity is best left to the private sector, with market forces being encouraged to operate.
Solemnly promise and swear to govern the people of the United Kingdom of Great Britain, the Northern Ireland, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, the Union of South Africa, Pakistan, and Ceylon, and of your possessions, the other territories, to any of them belonging or pertaining, according to their respective laws and customs.
The coronation of Queen Elizabeth II was a triumphant assertion of Britain's power in the world. But it was held in a city that was still ruined from the bombing of 10 years before. Britain had been bankrupted by the war, and many of those clustered around the new Queen knew that it could no longer afford to rule the world. But one man in the crowd was determined that Britain should remain great and powerful. And if the old ways would no longer work, then he would find a new way. He was Colonel David Stirling, a war hero famous for founding the Special Air Service, the SAS. What Stirling would do was to sell to other countries Britain's military power. Britain would supply them with modern weapons and with mercenaries who would fight their wars for them. In return, Britain would become rich again and continue to influence the world.
On the 14th of December 1941, a small party of British troops made their way cautiously onto the enemy airfield of Tamit in the Western Desert. It was a pitch-black night, and they were moving carefully for the very good reason that they were hundreds of miles behind Rommel's front line. And they belonged to an organization called the SAS, Special Air Service. They were really a private army, started, trained, and led by a young subaltern called David Stirling.
David Stirling came from a Scottish aristocratic family. With the SAS, he had invented a new revolutionary way of fighting a war. He had shown that with only a few men, he could destroy hundreds of enemy aircraft. To the army commanders, his methods were reckless. But to his supporters, it was a return to a golden age of British heroism.
The airfield packed with aircraft. And they roared onto it with all guns blazing, the real Nelson touch, in fact. Now, the only way that I can bring this alive for you is by a demonstration which I fixed up on this model for you to see what happened. Most of them had beards. A lot of them wore bandana handkerchiefs. They must have looked very like 18th century pirates. Now, what I always wonder is, how do men like this make out in peacetime?
After the war, David Stirling left the army and went to live in Rhodesia. Like many returning servicemen, he found post-war Britain drab and depressed. Stirling also believed that his duty was to help maintain Britain's empire. It was what he, like so many others, had fought to preserve.
He believed that he had that's the sort of thing that families like mine believed anyway, until fairly recently, probably. I mean, that you were powerful, that your birth gave you the right to power, but also gave you very great responsibilities for looking after the people who lived on the place or worked on the place. It's just in the blood, I think, too, you know. It's a birth thing. It's a birth thing.
The British do not give independence or freedom to anybody on the platter. You have to fight them for it. You must be prepared to go to prison. To face imprisonment or even death itself. They do not give it to you as a present.
In the 1950s, black nationalism spread through Africa. To try and stop it, Stirling set up his own political party called Capricorn Africa. He proposed an alternative form of power sharing where people like himself would civilize the black majority. It attracted wide support among the white middle-class settlers, but it was firmly rejected by politicians in London.
There are many people who take what you might call a sort of paternalist view about the African in Africa. They say, and this no doubt is true, that the European, for the time being at least, because of his greater knowledge and know-how and the rest of it, can run things better. And then they jump from that to assume that the European should stay there in control. Now, I've never accepted this analysis. It was about 50 years ago that Asquith said that self-government is better than good government, and I believe this to be true.
At the end of the 50s, Stirling returned to London. He was angry and disillusioned with the politicians. He felt they had lost the will to maintain Britain's power abroad. He also had nothing to do. He spent his time in Mayfair at private gambling parties.
Four, giving you three, is drawing a card.
The parties were arranged by another young aristocrat, John Aspinall.
I first met David Stirling when a friend of mine brought him along to one of my games. David, as a gambler, was very brave, reckless, of course, as you would expect, dangerous, because those sort of gamblers always are. He was quiet, but menacing in a funny sort of way. So with David, you always knew he'd strangled 41 men, and therefore it gave the man an aura. One wondered how many throats he'd slit.
In 1962, John Aspinall opened his own gambling club, the Clermont Club in Mayfair. Stirling was one of its members. The Clermont was deliberately designed to recreate a time when Britain had been rich and powerful.
It's been described as the most beautiful terrace house in London, built between 1742 and 1744 by William Kent, the royal architect, for Prince Freddie of Wales, who would have been King of England if he'd lived, but he died, I think, at the age of 39, for his mistress, the beautiful Isabella Finch Hatton.
I was trying to recreate some sort of 18th century world. The beauty of the decorations, the colour of everything, the abandon, sheer extravagance of it. And it was an atmosphere and an ambiance where strange plants could grow.
The set that Aspinall gathered around him at the Clermont were, like Stirling, disaffected right-wingers, men who felt themselves out of tune with the consensus politics of the post-war world. They included James Goldsmith, a playboy and ferocious gambler who was to become a close friend of Stirling's. The tycoon Tiny Rowland, who Stirling already knew from his time in Africa. Lord Lucan, a descendant of the man who had led the charge of the Light Brigade, and Jim Slater, the takeover tycoon and asset stripper who ran the notorious Slater Walker. What united all these men was a belief in decisive, reckless action. It was this, they believed, that had made Britain great, not moderate post-war governments.
Some people actually seek risk, and they put themselves at risk voluntarily. And I think this is a spirit that is to be admired. I think it's the spirit that built the prosperity that everybody in this country is enjoying today. It was created by adventurers, by merchant adventurers, by pirates, if you like Morgan and Drake.
Then, an event occurred in the Middle East, which gave Stirling the chance to try and reassert Britain's power abroad, but in a new, different way. In September 1962, Egyptian troops invaded the Yemen. They went in to support a military coup against the ruling Imam. The invasion terrified the West, because President Nasser of Egypt was backed by the Soviet Union, and he now threatened the oil fields of Saudi Arabia.
We have our troops there. We minimized the number of our troops. It depends about the attitude of Saudi Arabia, because if we leave Yemen without agreement, they will try to return the Imam back to Yemen. We'll stay there until we reach agreement with Saudi Arabia.
How long do you think this is going to be?
I don't know. We are ready to stay there for 10 years.
For the British, Nasser threatened far more than just oil. The Yemen overlooked the British base at Aden. It guarded British trading routes throughout the world. And right-wingers in the government feared that if the Egyptians, backed by the Soviets, attacked, they would paralyze Britain's economy. Their leader was Julian Amory.
The prosperity of our people rests really on oil of the Persian Gulf, the rubber and tin of Malaya, and the gold, copper, and precious metals of South and Central Africa. As long as we have access to these, as long as we can realize the investments we have there, as long as we can trade with this part of the world, we shall be prosperous. If the communists were to take them over, we would lose the lot. Governments like Colonel Nasser's in Egypt are just as dangerous.
David Stirling was a close friend of Julian Amory's, and together they were determined to find a way to stop Nasser. But Nasser had humiliated Britain once before at Suez, and they knew the British government would do nothing officially to stop him. They had neither the will nor the money. Stirling and Amory had dinner with the Foreign Secretary, Alec Douglas Hume, at White's Club in St. James's. They proposed a plan. A group of ex-SAS men would mount an operation to fight the Egyptians, but they would do it privately.
In this particular time, we're talking about in the 60s, the British governments had lost the will, in some ways, to engage in this sort of operation. There was a great need for stability. There was change taking place all around, revolutions, coups, and we could do something which the British government no longer had the will to do, helping to get rid of a foreign power in the Yemen. So it was logical for private enterprise to pick up this particular challenge, and particularly as we felt it was very important of British national interests.
The British government agreed to the idea. Stirling would help to organise a private war in the Yemen, but they wouldn't have to pay for it, and no one would ever know they were involved. But Stirling's team now had to find the money for both men and weapons. In secret, a member of the team flew to Saudi Arabia. Stirling already knew Prince Faisal, the most powerful of the king's sons. Faisal was terrified that Nasser would invade his country next, and agreed to the British idea. The Saudis would pay for the war.
Saudis saw David as a sort of their idea of a buccaneering Britain, an unusual who talked to them as if he was almost an Arab. Well, he didn't speak a word, except for sort of localized Arabic. I don't think he knew any sort of pidgin Arabic, but he talked to them as they understood him and respected him.
The Saudis' use of Stirling was nothing but an expression of need. They needed his services. They didn't have anybody with his expertise. They didn't have anybody of his stature and ability. That is very, very simple. In his case, I think to say that he was a mercenary is to sell him short. He was a mercenary, and simultaneously he was an extension of British policy. He wasn't doing anything illegal. This government knew about it and approved it. And therefore, he was sort of a merger between a mercenary and a Lawrence of Arabia, if you wish. You know, he brought these two things together, the romantic adventurer and the modern-day mercenary, came together in the person of Stirling.
The Saudis agreed to pay for the British mercenaries and also to smuggle weapons into the Yemen. The man in charge of the weapons would be a young trader, Adnan Khashoggi. Khashoggi found the weapons that Stirling's team needed from Britain and America, hundreds of rifles and machine guns left over from the Second World War.
They were not the type of arms they could get from their usual sources. They needed specialist arms, so for mountain warfare, guerrilla warfare, and things like that. That, of course, signaled the emergence of Khashoggi as an arms dealer. His first arms deal, Adnan Khashoggi's first arms deal had to do with the war in Yemen.
The other problem was to find the men. Stirling set about tracking down his old comrades from the SAS, but who had now left the regiment.
He said, you'll be leading a very small party and you will have professional soldiers with you, indicating that I was going to take professional SAS men in with me.
But this was not an SAS operation?
No.
What was it?
It was an international operation, supplying the Arab forces, training them, upsetting the Egyptians by mining their roads, ambushing, general nuisance. Mounted by governments who knew about it, but were not intimately connected at all stages.
So, if things went wrong?
If things went wrong, I'm afraid we would take the rap.
In 1964, an intrepid British aristocrat, Lord Kilbracken, made a film record of the British mercenaries' war in the Yemen. He travelled to the remote region where they were leading the royalist troops against the Egyptians.
The desert seemed endless. We saw only a barren, rocket-scarred mountainside, no tents, no houses, but up to 800 soldiers inhabit its caves and crannies. This is the Royalists' HQ. Here we met two of the British mercenaries. After morning drill, Bob and Co. would take their ease in the sun outside the cave which housed their radio station and was their safest air raid shelter.
That photograph was taken at about 8,000 foot above sea level. One had to be disguised, otherwise the information would get back and the Egyptians would come and bomb you. Parts of out and out war, mortaring and shooting up of their convoys. The capital was completely cut off from Hodeidah, their supply route from the sea. And we kept the Egyptians really tied down, and at one stage were completely running the country.
If the tribesmen were properly led, which is always terribly difficult, and properly directed, then we, with a small force, we could achieve a great success against a conscript army who didn't really want to be in the Yemen in the first place. It was very exciting. It was very exciting because at one stage one actually thought one was changing the course of history. And I think one felt that we could create countries in a better image if they were tied to Britain. It's probably an incredibly arrogant thing to say. But we just felt that we probably could.
What was invented in the Yemen was a new, private form of foreign policy for Britain, paid for by other countries' money. But then, at the very moment when Stirling's team seemed to be on the brink of success, an economic crisis hit Britain, which threatened his whole concept. In 1964, a new Labour government was elected. Almost immediately, there was a run on the pound.
Mr. Brown, yes. Have you been discussing the economic situation this morning?
We've been discussing the affairs of the nation, yes.
Try the American.
Have you got any money here, John Harvey?
Faced with Labour's promises of increased social spending, the markets panicked and began to pull their money out of Britain.
Sure? Nothing there at the moment.
A lot of the essential economic decisions for a government were taken externally and not inside the country at all.
And who were they taken by, those decisions?
They were taken by investors abroad deciding where to put their money, by bankers abroad deciding where to put their money, and by youngsters like the ones in this room who are speculating, sending billions of dollars across the exchanges every day in search of short-term profit.
Oui, je peux vous donner 5 millions de francs belges.
It was a battlefield with the markets. They were pressing for big increases in interest rates, increases in taxation, cuts in spending. And the markets can still do that to any country in the world.
The effect of the economic crisis was dramatic. To save the pound, Labour decided on wide-ranging spending cuts. And one of the main targets was defence. Dennis Healey had been made Minister of Defence, and in early 1965 he began a series of enormous cutbacks. He closed the overseas bases and brought the troops who had once protected the empire back home. It was a deliberate end to the idea that Britain was a great power.
I would really like to make this point very strongly. I don't think it is worthwhile spending a lot of money to try to change the course of history outside Europe or to protect national economic interests in foreign countries. We can't go on being the policemen for the whole world on our own forever.
Healey believed that instead, Britain's defence industries should make money for the country. The Americans were selling weapons throughout the world, and Healey wanted Britain to compete with them and to earn precious foreign currency. He appointed the country's most famous car salesman to advise on how to do this. He was Donald Stokes, head of Leyland Motors.
We're no longer a great world power. We're a commercial trading country now, and the sooner we appreciate this, the better. And unless we get the economy right, unless we get industry prosperous, it's no use politicians doing or thinking anything because they've no power left anymore. We've no power of armies or air forces. The only power we've got left is economic power. And we must deploy this for the benefit of us all to the best advantage to get the best return. We could be so prosperous if only we could get some sense into this.
But Britain was not very successful at selling weapons, until David Stirling decided to get involved. Stirling was furious with Healey's defence cuts. They had come at the very moment when he had finally won the war in the Yemen. In August 1965, Nasser effectively surrendered. He signed a ceasefire with the new king of Saudi Arabia, King Faisal. Nasser promised to begin withdrawing his troops from the Yemen.
We produced a situation where we'd won, where the Egyptians were prepared to pull out completely from the Yemen. They went to see King Faisal in Jeddah and agreed to go. And it was at that time that the new British government announced its intention to leave Arabia. So we'd actually won the game, which was probably why I got so cross. We'd actually won the game. And then it was given away politically because the Labour government was committed to a major defence cut.
Stirling believed that Labour had given away the fruits of his victory. By removing troops from the Middle East, they had left Saudi Arabia defenceless. Above all, with no air force. So Stirling approached King Faisal and offered to create an air force for him, privately. But first, Stirling had to find the planes. To do this, he went into partnership with a flamboyant British entrepreneur who lived in Jeddah, Geoffrey Edwards. Edwards went everywhere in a white Rolls Royce.
I live by exporting, and in many countries the Rolls Royce is regarded as the highest possible status symbol of someone's achievements. Everyone seems to want to own a Rolls Royce, or at least ride in one. In fact, many of my friends often say to me, the only chance I shall ever get to ride in Rolls Royce is at my funeral in a hearse. Amongst foreigners, it does have a great effect upon them to be met by a Rolls, think, oh, this is something, particularly to a chap you've never met before, and you're talking in terms of millions, which we often are doing in my particular game, or various games, I should say. To be met by a Rolls means to him, ah, oh, here's a man of substance, this is a man who has something behind him, we can trust him, he's good for his word, and money's good, etc., etc.
Together, Edwards and Stirling came up with an extraordinary scheme. They would persuade the British government to sell the brand new Lightning fighter to the Saudis, along with an entire defence network. And Stirling's team of ex-SAS men would help to run it. Saudi Arabia would be protected, and Britain would maintain its influence in the Middle East.
Well, the arms deal was brokered by Geoffrey Edwards and David Stirling, and the package would involve British planes, British training for the pilots, British training and, in the start, maintenance for the aircraft, and ground control, radar, and everything else. We were there prepared to give a training support, and we had already shown, you know, in Yemen and other things, that we had been a capability of doing it.
In a private way?
In a private way.
They wanted aircraft, radar, training, and guided weapons. The Lightning was an extremely sophisticated fighter aircraft, supersonic, the first British supersonic fighter aircraft, developed by English Electric, and they wanted this, they wanted the very latest type of fighter aircraft, and they wanted the latest type of radar. And of course, there were all sorts of security problems. The attitude of the embassy in Saudi Arabia was very lukewarm. It was gaining influence through trade. But the Foreign Office had not been involved in trade. It was thought to be slightly below the salt trade. Diplomacy was tip-top.
But Dennis Healy was in favour of the deal. It was a perfect example of what he wanted the Ministry of Defence to achieve. He gave it official government support. But Stirling and Edwards were facing serious opposition from the Americans. The Lockheed Corporation were trying to sell the Saudis their Starfighter instead. They produced slick commercials to show off the plane. They also took the precaution of hiring an agent in Saudi Arabia, Adnan Khashoggi. He told Lockheed that the only way to win the deal was to bribe the Saudi government. 10 years later, in a Senate investigation, Lockheed's chairman admitted what had happened.
I'd like to ask Mr. Cowden this question. Did Mr. Khashoggi inform you personally that if Lockheed was to obtain contracts in Saudi Arabia, public officials there in a position of influence would have to be paid off?
The answer to the question is yes. He has told me on several occasions that it was necessary for him to make payments to foreign, to Saudi officials, government officials.
Stirling and Edwards told the British government they would have to do the same as the Americans, pay commission to their agents in King Faisal's entourage. If they didn't, Britain would lose the deal.
Did you pay commissions to get this deal?
We paid commissions to our agents, yes.
Did you think that was wrong?
No. The agent lays out a lot of his own money, and if he doesn't, the deal doesn't go through, he loses his money. On that basis, I think it's a fair way of working. I knew some of the things that went on in Saudi Arabia, of course, that payments were made to people. I would not call them bribes, they were payments a cut on the deal for people who were involved in it, and that was the custom of the country. They have different ethical standards to ourselves. For instance, people in Saudi Arabia have lots of different wives. We don't have that in this country, but it isn't a good reason for not doing, for failing to do business with them.
When the British government accepted the principle of commissions being paid, it was looking the other way on an act of corruption. They knew this was corruption, but they thought of it in terms of, this is Middle East corruption, this is the way things are done in the Middle East. And I would have dared anyone at the time to tell Stirling that he was not behaving honorably. He believed he was behaving honorably. You could accuse him of a certain level of naivety, but you could not doubt his honor in terms of serving the purposes of Britain. But the activity is, by nature, corrupt.
In December 1965, the Saudis announced they would buy the British planes. The bribes had worked. It was the biggest export deal in Britain's history, and King Faisal came on a state visit to celebrate it. It was also the beginning of the modern arms trade with the Middle East, which has grown to dominate Britain's economy. And from it also came a much wider commercial relationship with Saudi Arabia.
It gave us a great leverage in. It brought a lot of Britons in at a time when there were very, very few. And a lot of things came along as byproducts of this particular deal. Deals for hospitals, deals for all sorts of things, deals for building roads, deals for building palaces, deals for building airfields. It all came as a byproduct, a major, major, major byproduct. So this £100 million arms sale came to be worth billions in terms of trade for Britain, and also it maintained our influence there to this present day.
With the Saudi deal, Stirling had reasserted Britain's power in the Middle East, and it had cost nothing. But it was only the start. As the limits of Britain's official power in the world became ever more clear, Stirling found other ways to secretly influence the policies of other countries. And again, he would run it as a business. By the late 60s, many of Britain's former colonies were being torn apart by civil war. In Nigeria, the federal government were fighting a vicious campaign to stop Biafra from seceding. The British government were secretly supplying the federal side with weapons. Their aim was to protect Britain's oil interests in Nigeria. But the Sunday Telegraph printed an internal government report which exposed this, and there was an outcry. The man who leaked the report was an idealistic young journalist, Jonathan Aitken.
If you had known in advance how much trouble it would have caused, would you once again have passed on that report to the Sunday Telegraph?
Well, my goodness, that's a difficult question. I think the answer really is this, that given that situation of that ghastly war going on, and given the fact that I believed I received that information in good faith, I think it was my duty as a journalist, and indeed as a citizen of this country, to pass on that information. So I think the real answer is, yes, I would do it again.
There were protests throughout Africa. Britain was seen as helping the Nigerian government to pursue a policy of genocide. The scandal also split opinion in Britain.
Should we stop sending arms to Nigeria? Whether this would have any effect or not, should we stop sending them now?
Yes.
Hugh Fraser.
To my mind, it's a very simple, and the answer is yes. The alternative is, as proposed by people like Woodrow Wyatt and an MP in the Times today, is to keep up with the Russians. This is morally absolutely intolerable. It's politically inept. Your policy is losing out. You're making a fool of ourselves throughout the world. The people are regarding this country with moral obloquy. It's not this medical, it's the policy has failed.
If we don't supply arms to the Nigerian government, the Russians are going to go on doing it. The Russians have told the Nigerian government that whatever happens, they're going to see them through to victory. Well, is it wise that we should allow the whole of this vast area, with 52 million people in it, with more oil in it than Kuwait, to fall into the hands of the Russians? I mean, it's absolutely crazy.
The federal government won, helped by the British arms. But the resulting scandal clearly showed the limits of Britain openly using arms sales as a tool of foreign policy. As coups and civil wars spread through the Third World, Stirling was determined to find a subtler way to maintain Britain's influence in the world. He set up a secret organisation called Watchguard. Its job was to provide African and Middle Eastern leaders with a private army of British mercenaries. They would prevent the leaders that Stirling approved of from being overthrown.
The idea behind Watchguard was to use David's expertise and connections with the SAS to enable these governments in their early years to have a fully trained and expert security, similar to what we have in this country for government ministers and travelling ambassadors. It was to enable them not to be vulnerable to violent overthrow.
For the avoidance of any doubts, the following are emphasized. A. The President, the Vice President, and all ministers and their deputies are dismissed from office. B. Parliament is dissolved. C. The Council of State is abolished. D. All political parties are proscribed. It is therefore illegal for any person or persons to belong to or operate under any...
One of the things that often happened for a coup, for instance, was for the radio station to be taken over and people to announce that the government had been overthrown. So one of the things we did, for instance, would be to have alternative radio stations which would come on to demand, to say that this is simply not true.
Watchguard was a great success. Stirling organised protection for leaders in Africa and the Middle East. And as his mercenaries got close to the leaders, they also became influential.
Anybody who was involved in the personal security of any ruler gets very close to that ruler and to his ministers. Very close indeed.
And how much influence can one then have?
Immense.
In Oman, many of the Sultan's advisors were ex-SAS men. They ran the Sultan's guerrilla war against Marxist rebels. The rebels made a propaganda film attacking the Sultan and his British mercenaries. But the British won.
Militarily, how secure is Oman now?
Militarily, totally secure. I believe that there is no way in which the enemy can recapture those positions down there, and there is no other way in which he can bring supplies into Dhofar to sustain a revolution.
By the early 70s, Stirling had become a successful businessman. He arranged enormous arms deals, and his mercenaries kept many Third World leaders in power. Almost single-handedly, Stirling had created the foundations of Britain's modern privatised foreign policy. It is a hidden world of vicious guerrilla wars fought by British mercenaries, a world that occasionally surfaces in scandals like the Sandline affair. It all began with Stirling selling Britain's military power to countries he approved of.
As long as these countries were friendly countries, where there was no conflict between Stirling, the ultimate expression of Britishness, and the policies of that country, he was certainly willing to provide his services. in terms of buying arms, in terms of training, in terms of undertaking missions, actually. He was a man of many parts, a dynamo, a very likable man. So he was acting in a private capacity, but he was acting in cahoots with the British government. There's no doubt about it.
And that was new?
That was new for a private person, yes, yes.
But then, in the early 70s, Stirling had a terrible car crash in the Scottish Highlands. He nearly died and spent a long time recovering at his family estate, Keir, in Scotland. Stirling was forced to give up all his mercenary activities and his arms dealing. He went into semi-retirement. His crusade to keep Britain powerful seemed to be over.
As Prime Minister, I want to speak to you simply and plainly about the grave emergency now facing our country. In the House of Commons this afternoon, I announced more severe restrictions on the use of electricity. We are limiting the use of electricity to 3 days a week. The reason why is quite simple. The problem of the supply of oil and the problem of the rise in the price of oil. Jobs will be in danger, and take-home pay will be less. In terms of comfort, we shall have a harder Christmas than we have known since the war.
The price of oil had been massively increased as a result of the Arab-Israeli war. The oil-producing states, led by King Faisal of Saudi Arabia, were furious at American support for Israel. Their action had catastrophic effects on the Western economies.
Doesn't this new massive increase in the price of oil mean a change in the world balance of power between the developing nations like you, the producers, and us, the developed industrialized nations?
Yes, it will.
And what do you think arises from that?
Well, a new type of relationship. You have to adjust yourself to the new circumstances. And I think you have to sit down and talk seriously with us about this new era.
In 1974, David Stirling came back to Mayfair. He found it completely transformed. It had become the social centre for the oil-rich Arabs. And the Clermont Club had changed too. It had been taken over by the Playboy organisation, and they allowed Arabs in for the first time.
When I took over at the Clermont Club, Arabs had been excluded from the Clermont. And we opened the doors to them, the very rich Arabs who were gamblers. And that made the club. I was able to pay for the club in 6 months. We sort of maintained the exclusivity by only inviting those Arabs who were big gamblers to join the Clermont too.
Again, it's what one brings to the table. Arabs knew that they were mixing with the likes of British aristocracy, and their passport was money. The Arabs had their money. The English, maybe that Clermont crowd, felt they had their aristocracy, their lineage, their sheer snobbery. They knew the Arabs would have loved to have been part of it, and they could pay the price. It's nothing new here. I mean, we had aristocracy marrying heiresses, American heiresses, to bring money to the families. This is nothing new. But it was blatant in the 70s. It was in their faces.
One has to say, putting it as tastefully as one possibly can, that I think some of them are a little unfamiliar with the Western military. I mean, I can understand that if you walk in and you haven't seen one before, it does look a very strange and unsympathetic object. And quite obviously, rather than using it, an awful lot of them have preferred to use the floor. And unfortunately, without clearing up some of the mess over a long period.
What has been the result of that in the flats?
Well, its main unpleasantness has been the smell, which has come up the ventilating shafts with such ferocity on some afternoons that we haven't been able to go into the bathrooms. I mean, I must say that the aroma of Levantine remains, and it will be with me to the day I drop.
The other effect of the oil price rise on Britain was industrial chaos. Government attempts to hold down wages led to violent strikes. To Stirling, it seemed as if the country he had fought to keep great was now collapsing from inside. So as a man of action, he decided he was going to do something about it.
He felt that the country was getting out of control, that again, stability of this country was now really threatened. He felt that the extreme unions were very dangerous, that there was a sort of possibility of an undemocratic action taking place in this country. And he felt that this was a time for planning a contingency operation to stop this happening.
David Stirling returned to his traditional recruiting ground, the clubs of Mayfair. He formed an organisation called Great Britain 75. It was a group of military men, many of them ex-SAS. They planned to take over the running of Britain if the strikes led to the collapse of civil order.
If a political strike is going to cause the country and the economy irreversible damage, we're there to come in and help to avoid that occurring. And we also believe that if we didn't exist, and the left-wing activists create this situation of this general strike, which would result in the surge being out in the streets within a few hours in certain areas, and we believe that government would be unable to negotiate under that sort of duress.
You talk about patriotism, but surely your organisation is an indication that you haven't got much faith in government to deal with the situation.
I've got awfully little faith in the present situation of Parliament as a whole, whether it's Conservative or Socialist. If we had that faith, then and we thought that the government could deal with this handful of left-wing activists, there'd be no need for our existence.
All those in favour of that procedure, please show.
Stirling also formed a secret organisation within the trades union movement itself.
It's not carried.
Its job was to fight and undermine the left-wing union leaders.
Let's have some quiet, will you? It's quite out of order for people to interrupt the way...
One of Stirling's main supporters was Kate Lazinska of the Civil and Public Servants Association.
What David Stirling was really concerned about was the threat of communist infiltration, not only within the trade union movement, but in other elements that mattered in this country.
And what did he set out to do?
He set out to create, if you like, a group of people who understood what was happening and would fight and do something about it.
Experienced, over.
Kate, I must tell you that if you do not leave the rostrum... Kate, if you do not leave the rostrum, I will switch the power off.
You're wrong.
He planned it like a military operation, and he would teach us to identify at any particular point in time what the next job should be, what our next move should be. He was very good at this. He would say, well, you know, now is the time to make this move or that move. I suppose it was a bit like being in the army.
Much of the money to fund Stirling's operations came from his friend at the Clermont Club, James Goldsmith. Like Stirling, Goldsmith believed that politicians no longer had the power to control Britain. It should be done instead by men trained in what he called executive action.
Let's make it quite clear that if you take a nation which is one of the most prosperous, one of the finest, one of the most dominant, one of the most influential in the world, and turn it in 20 years into a relative pauper of Europe, an invalid of the world, everything has to be wrong and everybody is to blame. Our tradition is that the leaders in Parliament, in government, are drawn from Parliament, from the House of Commons principally. People with practically no experience of executive action at all. Now, what I'm suggesting is that they are not equipped for doing that, taking that executive action, and that they should be drawn from the nation.
At this very moment, power was taken away from the British politicians, but not by Stirling or Goldsmith or their friends in the clubs of Mayfair. It was by the Arabs. The very people who Stirling had once tried to control now stepped in to change Britain's domestic policy. In early 1976, the markets started to panic about Britain's economy. Foreign investors started to withdraw their money, and the pound slid dramatically. This crisis was far greater than Britain had ever experienced before, because the markets were now so much more powerful. And the reason was Arab oil money.
The power of the market had increased because of the explosion in oil prices, which meant that the Arab countries particularly, which produced the oil in the Middle East and had no way of spending it internally because they had very small populations, had to find somewhere to put it abroad where it would earn as much as possible through high interest rates and of course increase in value through appreciation. And this totally transformed the international financial climate, and that meant that a lot of the essential economic decisions for a government were taken externally and not inside the country at all.
It dropped 100 points, we don't know why. It just dropped 100 points when everything else was staying steady.
Through the summer of 1976, Arab oil money continued to leave London. The heads of Arab banks now became powerful figures. They appeared on British television and explained what the government would have to do to save both itself and the country.
Unless really action is taken to put confidence again in Stirling and in the British economy, I believe unless this happens, money is bound to fly from London. Everybody knows the economy has been destroyed through strikes, rampant strikes, organized strikes. I feel that the position is so serious now that we should, that you should consider a sort of a coalition government where actions should be taken for the interest of the economy of the country, regardless of what effect they will have. Because this, in the long run, is in the interest of the public in general.
Would these tough new measures that you've spoken about bring Arab money back into the British economy?
Absolutely.
They were worried because there was a Labour government. It didn't seem to have control over what the trade unions were doing. A rash of strikes, of course, sent trade and output plunging. And it was quite natural that the markets would react by wanting to get out of sterling and into dollars, or Deutsche Marks in some cases, but mainly dollars.
Is that power?
Well, yes, it is, but there are a million ways of defining power. But if power is the ability to produce changes in the behavior of other people, then of course the markets do have very strong power, and the markets did compel me to change policy.
Dennis Healey began a series of savage cuts in public expenditure. It was the only way, he believed, for Britain to get a loan from the IMF and avoid bankruptcy. But it was clear to many in his party that he had given away control of the economy to the markets.
I'm going to negotiate with the IMF on the basis of our existing policies, not changes in policies. And I need your support to do it. But when I say existing policies, I mean things we don't like as well as things we do like. It means sticking to the very painful cuts in public expenditure on which the government's already decided. That's what it means, and that's what I'm asking for. That's what I'm going to negotiate for, and I ask the conference to support me in that task.
Arab money now flooded back into London, and it became one of the mainstays of the British economy. Much of it went to buy arms. 10 years before, David Stirling had begun arms exports to the Middle East as a way of influencing Arab nations. But now it was just business. The Grenadier Guards greeted their customers in Arabic, simply in order to get their money.
Al-Faras, Al-Shara, Al-Fuqa, Al-Thaniya, Grenadier Guards, Jahidse, Itar, Kudukum, Saidi.
The process that Stirling and people like him began became cynical. It became, we're going back to see the Saudis because we want part of this big money they're hoarding back. How dare they, you know, amass so much wealth? So it wasn't the same romantic idea.
How is business at the moment? What sort of deals are you pulling off?
Well, very good at the moment. I think that there's an enormous amount of business in the world. We've signed a number of deals in the Middle East, for instance, in the area of 700 million, another one for 200 million, deals in the offing, which could add up to 1,000 million. And I think it's part of our natural courtesy to these people to make sure that they have a very pleasant stay in Britain, then they might actually buy from us.
If you went to one of Mayfair's hotels in the middle 70s and sat in the lobby, you would be surrounded by mixed groups of people huddling over paper, trying to exchange information about some kind of a deal in the making, mostly whispering, because it always involved commissions, you know, doing this, exchanging specifications, getting secret tips of how to handle it, telling somebody, you know, we have the approval of the cabinet. And this is where corporate corruption in the UK started. And this is where the corruption of people in government also started. They started paying members of the government commission to facilitate the deal itself. And so we've gone full circle. By looking the other way and sanctioning corruption, corruption has eventually come back to infect the institutions of this country.
David Stirling finally retired for good, but not to his family castle. Because of debts, his family were forced to sell it to an Arab businessman. Stirling's mercenaries returned home after 20 years of trying to keep Britain powerful. The country they came back to was very different from the one they had left.
I found a rather sad Britain in many ways. I found corruption creeping in more and more in government, in local government, and in private life. And I must admit that I wasn't very happy with what I saw. So in many ways, the Britain that I had been projecting in the Middle East and in Africa and in the Far East was not the Britain which really existed. And I found that very sad.
Well, I don't know about you, but I think you've had your money's worth. Halloween over, but always remember, be like Harry Lauder and keep right on to the end of the road. Keep right on to the end. Though the way be long, let your heart be strong. Keep right on around the bend. And though you're tired and weary, still journey on till you come to your happy.
Cock a snook at Your Life Insurance and join Ray Mears and Michael Palin for Adventure Night on UK TV documentary in a moment. Next, here on History, find out what the Stuarts did for us.